We've got a wonderful presentation, and to kick it off, we have a professor from right here in New York, Medgar Evers College at CUNY, the City University of New York. Please give a big round of applause for Terrence Blackman, who's going to kick off tonight's program.
It is a genuine privilege and an honor to introduce our remarkable speaker, Dr. Talithia Williams, professor of mathematics and the mathematics clinic director at Harvey Mudd College. As I was thinking about this, I wanted to say two things. One, I met Dr. Williams some years ago. My thesis advisor, John Velling, was an undergraduate at Harvey Mudd, and we were at the joint math meetings, and at the joint math meetings, Harvey Mudd has their own little Harvey Mudd type activity. And so my thesis advisor took me there, and we were welcomed really genuinely sort of gracious welcome. And so I've always had a very soft spot in my heart for Dr. Williams because, you know, she made me feel very at home. And as I was thinking about this, I noted the photograph that I noted the a connection between Medgar Evers College and Harvey Mudd. The chair, Francis Su, had done some work with our chair in the past, Umesh Nagarkati. And I have this photograph of myself and the faculty at Medgar Evers College with the chair of Harvey Mudd. So I think there's a nice resonance that you're here today. And I want to say that Dr. Williams is indeed a trailblazer in the field of mathematics, and an inspiring advocate for the use of data to improve our health and well-being. Her research focuses on developing statistical models that capture spatial and temporal patterns in data, and applying these models to tackle real-world problems. One of her notable collaborations has been with the World Health Organization, where she developed a predictive model to determine cataract surgical rates in African countries. You know, this work evidently sort of highlights, you know, her ability to apply sophisticated mathematics to global health challenges. And I think it demonstrates her commitment to making data-driven decisions accessible and impactful on a broad scale. I should say that Dr. Williams has a BS in mathematics from Spelman College, a master's degree in mathematics and statistics from Howard University and Rice University, and a PhD in statistics from Rice. Dr. Williams' journey really captures the height of her dedication to STEM in some very real ways. She's held prestigious research positions at NASA, at the National Security Agency, and at the Jet Propulsion Lab. I wanted to add one more personal note to this introduction. So Dr. Williams' work is particularly relevant today as we face significant health disparities within in particular African-American communities. And I served as a dean of the School of Science, Health, and Technology at Medgar Evers College, and I would begin every one of our school meetings with two sort of facts, which I think they're always important, and I think Dr. Williams' work kind of addresses this. The life expectancy for African-Americans is currently about 74.8 years, and this is noticeably lower than the national average. So that's kind of going out. And coming in, the infant mortality rate for African Americans is approximately about 10.8 deaths per 1,000, more than twice that of some other groups. And these statistics reflect systemic challenges that demand innovative, data-driven solutions, and Dr. Williams' research shows us how to integrate body data through these wearable technologies, and that these things can bridge those gaps, providing kind of personalized insights that can lead to healthier lives. And so, that being said, I want you to join me in welcoming Dr. Talithia Williams. We're thrilled to have her here, and I'm sure you'll enjoy the talk.
Thank you so much, Dr. Blackman, Terrence. It's always great to have a friend to come and introduce me, and I'm always nervous if he's going to give you a little dirt, so fortunately it was very clean, but thank you. He and his wife are celebrating their 15th wedding anniversary today, so I appreciate him coming out on a wedding anniversary to hang out with us. So thank you. I'm going to jump right in. I'm excited to talk about empowering health. Before that, I do that, I just want to give you a chance to get to know me a little bit. For some of you, this is my first time meeting you. So here's a bit about me. I grew up in Columbus, Georgia, about 100 miles south of Atlanta. So this is me as a young child. Notice me and the old person have glasses. I've been wearing glasses my whole life. Third grade is when it first started, which is right around the time this picture was taken. And I also grew up in the 90s where AP classes were first introduced. So that was sort of when AP classes were first coming out in Georgia. And I signed up for all of them because, you know, my ninth grade year was like the first year that AP classes were offered. I hate to date myself, but. And at my school, it was just like our teachers were still learning how to teach it. So all my friends were like, we got to take these AP classes because they don't really know what they're doing quite yet. And so we signed up. And so I also took AP calculus my senior year. That was sort of my first introduction to a really rigorous calculus course. My teacher, Mr. Dorman, was an old white guy. And I said, the older I get, the more I realize he was young. He was like his early 50s. I'm like, he was a young man. He was full of life. At 17, I thought he was old. But now I'm just like, he was vibrant. He was vibrant. Mr. Dorman asked me to stay after class one day. And he said, I was like, okay. And I wasn't the best math student. I was like a B- sort of math student, middle of the road. And I thought to myself, well, maybe he's probably great at my calculus exam and he wants to let me know that I didn't do too well. And so after class, Mr. Dorman says, Talithia, you're really talented in math. You should think about majoring in it when you go to college. And my first thought was, he obviously is not great at my calculus exam yet, because he would know that it is, you know, me majoring in math is not a possibility. But I was really shocked because he sort of invited me to the mathematical table in a way that I didn't expect, from a person who I didn't expect it to come from. So Mr. Dorman was the one who sort of planted the seed that I could be a mathematician. And he actually did that to everybody, every random day. He'd be like, Susan, let me see you after class. Hey, yeah, Jillian, after class, let me talk. And we were just like, ooh, Susan's in trouble today. And so it was great because he encouraged all of us to major in math, whether we were an A student or whether we were flunking AP calculus, it did not matter. And I think that really had an impact because I saw myself as a mathematician after that moment. I went to Spelman College where I majored in math because Mr. Dorman said I should, and so I thought, sure. Here I am with the late Dr. Etta Faulkner. She was one of the first black women to get a PhD in mathematics. She was on the faculty at Spelman, and she taught me abstract algebra the second time I had to take it. And Dr. Faulkner was great. She encouraged me to think about graduate school, which I had never really thought about before, because I'm like, I got a bachelor's degree in math. Like, you can do wonders in the state of Georgia, you know, with a math degree. And Spelman is right across the street from Morehouse College, which is the all-men's college. Spelman's a historically black college for women. And so Dr. Faulkner would always tell us, like, you don't need to go to Morehouse. Leave those boys alone. Focus on your studies, you know. And so as she was talking to me about graduate schools, I started to research schools, and I had a list of places I wanted to go. And on that list was Cornell University, because there was a great mathematician there, Carlos Castillo Chavez, and I wanted to work with Carlos. And so I'm going over my list with her. I said, well, you know, I'm going to apply to Cornell. She said, oh, you're not going to go to Cornell. I said, well, you know, I found a person I can work with. He does, you know, I'm excited about his research. She's like, I'm not going to write you a letter for Cornell. I was like, well, what's wrong with Cornell? She's like, you can't find a husband in Ithaca. There's no, your books aren't going to keep you warm at night. And so I was like, whoa, like you're from the woman who told us, like, don't go across the street. And now she's like, you got to think about where you're going to get married and where you're going to find a husband. So I started my PhD journey at Howard University as doing theoretical math. I took a biostatistics course and fell in love with statistics. So I transferred to Rice University in Houston to finish a PhD in statistics there. This was graduation day. So yes, I found a husband, check. We got pregnant, I had a little baby, check. So I was very productive. I was pushing out dissertations and pushing out babies and just the utmost productivity. Here's my advisor, Dr. Kathy Enzer. That was our graduation day, and then we caught up with each other about maybe 6 or so months ago to get an updated picture. So I really enjoyed my time at Rice. I also, as Terrence mentioned, spent some time at NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory. I got to work in Lonnie Lane's lab. This was really a lot of fun for me. We worked on the Europa mission, which is actually planned, still in the planning of NASA to be completed. Europa is one of Jupiter's moons, believed to be covered in ice. And so I got to work on the team that was looking at how the probe would melt through the ice in order to sample for life form underneath. So that was a lot of fun. This was also my first time doing research. So it was the first time sort of using mathematics in a way that connected to other disciplines. It was really exciting to be at a table that was really interdisciplinary. And so we're all thinking about how we bring our expertise to the table to solve that problem. Spent some time at the National Security Agency. Love to tell you what I did, but you know, nobody wants to die today. NSA was fun. You can't bring your work home because everything's top secret. So it was like the best place to work because it was like, oh, my day is over and I'm just going to go home and not do anything. So that was really a lot of fun. One day I did accidentally bring like a non-top secret paper home that was sort of in my things. And so I got home, I was like, oh, there's this paper. So I called the number that you call when you accidentally bring something home. And I said, I accidentally brought this home. It's not top secret, but you know, it came home. And so they made a note of it. So the next day I'm pulling in, I'm scanning. And they were like, oh, Dr. Williams, you need to pull over here to the side. And I was just like, oh, they're about to kill me. They're about to kill me. So that was a really fun time working at the NSA. Here's where you can find me. I'm on the faculty at Harvey Mudd College. It's one of the Claremont colleges out in Southern California. One thing I love about our faculty is that we really want students to see themselves as mathematicians, see themselves in science and STEM. And so we really want to make sure that they can find themselves in our faculty. So we look for a really diverse representation to really excite our students and help them see themselves in our field. And then, of course, I'm a mom and a wife. Here's my mom, my husband Donald, our three boys, Josiah, Noah, Micaiah. And so it's really sort of a really full and complete life that I enjoy. They wanted to make this trip to New York City, but you know, so it's just some mommy time. But it's really amazing to get to share life and do life with them. Okay, so my first sort of foray into really sort of connecting with the public and thinking about math communication and how to share math in exciting ways was through this partnership with NOVA and PBS through Nova Wonders. Nova Wonders is a 6-part series that looked at some of the biggest questions in science. Can we build a brain? What's the universe made of? What are animals saying? And even though none of these are my research topic, so the thing that unified them is the fact that they all deal with data, right? And how do we interpret data in a way that makes sense? So anytime data came up, I got to come on screen and talk about the data and really kind of explain it, hopefully in a way that doesn't make people want to change the channel. All right, I did this TEDx talk on owning your body's data. We'll talk a little bit about that today. So it talks about how you can use data that you collect in order to make informed, better health decisions with your healthcare provider. And then I got to author this really fun book, Power in Numbers, The Rebel Women of Mathematics, which highlighted some of the women who have come before us in the mathematical sciences and their journey and their stories, beautifully illustrated. I wanted the subtitle to be Women Mathematicians with Attitude, like adding, addition. Yeah, you caught thinking. It was punny. It was meant to be punny. Yeah, they didn't think so either. So it's Rebel Women of Mathematics. Okay, in thinking about empowering health, as Terrence mentioned, there is also sort of an undue burden of how disease affects folks. So I want to talk about that with you for a second. In thinking about health disparities,
right? So some of the social determinants of health. The Center for Disease Control defines health disparities as preventable differences in the burden of disease, injury, violence, or opportunities to achieve optimal health that are experienced by socially disadvantaged populations. All right, so question for you, what causes health disparities? What are some things that cause health disparities? And we're gonna need you to speak into the mic since we're recording. What causes health disparities? Any ideas?
Hi, miseducation.
Oh, miseducation, love that. Yes, what else? What causes? Yes, get those hands up. Yes, yes.
Just how you were brought up, your childhood influences.
Right, your environment, your childhood influences, beautiful. What else? Yes.
Differences in health insurance access, and also that's determined by the employer,
right,
or government.
Right, access to quality care. Wonderful. Other thoughts? Yes.
Access to healthcare providers themselves.
Mm-hmm. Right. So getting the healthcare providers, right? Often they don't live in maybe more rural areas, so you don't have access. Yes, I see your hand all the way in the back. We're getting your steps in today. Yes.
That's right.
Genetics.
Yes, your genetics also plays a part. Wonderful. I love it. Here's some things, many of what you said, sometimes poverty, environmental threats. How many of us are drinking the water in Flint? Maybe not. Access to healthcare, educational inequalities, all these can affect, right, the social determinants of health. When we look at the data, only 20% of your health outcomes are actually attributed to your clinical care, your doctor's visits, the fact that you brush your teeth twice a day, the fact that you eat a pretty clean diet, right? 20% of your health outcomes are attributed to that. The other 80% is tied to social and economic factors, your physical environments, health behaviors, your genetics. When you look at Medicare plans, 91% of them report activities that need to address the social determinants of health. But only 19 of the 50 states actually require Medicaid plans to screen for and provide referrals for social needs. So even though we know that this is a large component of someone's health, we're not necessarily checking for it, and we don't know what to do when folks have it. If you talk to doctors, 85% of them report that unmet social needs leads to poorer health outcomes. So if you can't get to a grocery store, if you don't have a grocery store within 5 to 10 miles of your home, then we know that you're probably not eating very healthy because you don't have access to fresh food on a consistent, frequent basis. But only 20% of physicians are confident in their ability to address those unmet social needs. So even though I know you live in a food desert, I'm not able to give you a Metro card to take the bus for free. I'm not able to give you a way to get food delivered to your house, for example. So I'm not able to address that unmet social need. Also, if you look at rural patients, there are lots of barriers for folks that don't live in great cities like New York, but don't have as much access to care. So that might be the financial means. Maybe they don't have dental or health insurance. They may have a job, say at Walmart, that's not gonna give you a paid day off to go to a medical appointment. You're just gonna have to take unpaid leave. Maybe there's a lack of confidence in how I can communicate with my healthcare provider if I speak a different language, or trusting that they won't compromise my privacy, or a lack of belief that I'm gonna receive quality care. So all of these then affect the healthcare outcomes in our country. All right, are you ready for a pop quiz? That did not sound like y'all were ready. Are you ready for a pop quiz? Okay, yes, all right. I'm gonna show you some data and give you a second to look at it with your neighbor and talk it over. We're gonna look at the leading causes of death by race and ethnicity. I wanna see what stands out to you. Women, right, leading causes of death. Data from 2018 hasn't changed much. Okay, I'll give you just a second to look at it by yourself. Okay, with your neighbor, take a couple minutes and just talk through what stands out to you. to the two of you with your neighbor, what do you notice? Anything stand out to you? So take a second and talk that over with your neighbor. All right, you got some ideas? Are you ready to share out? Yes, okay, let's hear your thoughts. What stands out to you in this data set? What do you notice?
We noticed that heart disease and cancer are the top two for everyone. And it looked like for the non-Hispanic American Indian and Alaska Native is the only one that has liver disease as one of the top.
Yeah.
I thought that diabetes would be higher.
Oh, yes. Overall for everyone? Yes, coming in here at seventh place overall. What else?
There's also a lot of, I've noticed, respiratory diseases too, mm-hmm. when you get a little bit lower.
Yeah, respiratory diseases stand out, especially among white women. It's the third leading cause of death among white women, respiratory diseases. Yes.
Yeah, so I can barely see the chart, but the first comment about liver disease, mm-hmm. that also has social aspects to it.
Yes.
The same thing with cancers, what kind of cancers.
Right.
Does somebody who has, like you were saying about food, does somebody with diabetes have access to fresh food? So all of these go into branches of
That's right.
other things.
That's right, yeah. Here were some things that sort of stood out to me. So especially between non-Hispanic Asian and then non-Hispanic Native Hawaiian and Pacific Islander, cancer's over 25% of the death rate. So over a quarter, over one in four, are dying each year from cancer. Unintentional injuries was pretty surprising. Okay. Hypertension makes the list for non-Hispanic Asian and Black, and then of course that chronic lower respiratory disease for non-Hispanic white women. Okay, guys, we didn't leave you out. Do not want to leave you out. I'll give you a second to look that over and then talk over with your neighbor what stands out to you for the men. All right, we got some thoughts for the men. I want to hear from the back of the room, folks in the back, especially on this side. I haven't heard from y'all either. Yes, yes. What are your thoughts?
So two thoughts.
Yes.
One is that, well, it's not exact, but I think the first two rows for men are pretty much flipped between men and women, mm. basically. The heart disease and cancer flip places.
Yeah.
And then the other thing that's interesting to me is that homicide and suicide make appearances
yes.
for the men.
Yes, homicide and suicide, yeah.
I'm surprised by the numbers for Alzheimer's. I had seen heavy prevalence among women.
Mm-hmm.
It seems to be widely varying among men.
Yeah.
It's come down a lot to 2%, and then, but on the other hand, non-Hispanic Blacks have 8%. That's
yes, yes, absolutely. So it's interesting to see sort of what diseases are affecting different groups and different genders. Ah, yes, yes. One and then two, yeah.
The fact that non-Hispanic Black show homicide and non-Hispanic White does not.
Mm-hmm. Yep, so you see homicide showing up for non-Hispanic Black, showing up here for Hawaiian Pacific Islander as well, for Hispanic, yes.
Yeah, and we were surprised to see unintentional injuries.
Man,
number
What are y'all doing? Yeah.
Lots of reckless stuff.
Lots of reckless stuff. Unintentional injuries. Yeah, yeah. So here were a few that stood out. Many that you mentioned, suicide, Alzheimer's disease, unintentional injuries, liver disease, sclerosis of the liver. One thing I thought was interesting is that suicide does not show up for Black men. Okay. So you might argue they die at the hands of each other, but they don't kill themselves. So it's suicide in the Black community
right, is not in the top 10 for black men. So as we think about sort of these health disparities, the question then becomes, what are some strategies we can use to then eliminate them? How can we work toward minimizing some of these health disparities? And I argue that we need to create a culture of data agency. What do I mean by that? Like, how do we encourage people to really take ownership of their data in a way that is going to be helpful for themselves and for the future? When Donald and I were pregnant with our third child, we were in sort of the 39th, 40th, 41st week of pregnancy, and we'd start going in for visits to the doctor to check the health of the baby and the heart rate of the baby. And so we went in for one of these routine stress tests. They call them stress tests for any moms in the group that have had to have those before. Yes, I see some heads nodding. And rarely are you seen by your own doctor. You're seen by whoever's on call. They come in, they put the things on you, you lay down for 20 minutes, and then they say, oh, your baby's heart rate's in the normal zone. See you tomorrow, you know? I did one of these stress tests. I went in with my husband, Donald. We did a stress test. The doctor comes out. He's like, oh, your baby's under stress. We're going to go ahead and induce you. Let's get you a room. And I said, well, tell me more. Like, what can I see the data? Can we look at the chart? Like, what kind of stress? And so he sort of reluctantly pulls up the chart. He says, here's the baby's heart rate zone. Here's where we expect to see it. And it's up here for about 18 of the 20 minutes, but then it sort of fluctuates. And it fluctuates down to what my zone was. And I said, it looks like it's just pulling up my data. So, like, is he under stress or... maybe it's just like I was moving and it caught my heart rate. And the doctor says, well, we don't want to take any chances. We'll just get you a room. Don't worry. Don't you worry your little pretty little head about this chart, you know. And I said, well, why don't we just, let's do it again. I'll be really still. Let's collect more data and see, like, is the baby really under stress? Because I didn't want to be induced. Those of you, anybody been induced? Yeah. It throws your body into labor. It sort of puts the child under distress because all of a sudden your body's like, get out, now's the time, you know. And it increases your probability of having a C-section. So those were all things that I didn't want preferably. And so I said, if you saw this data at 36 weeks, would you still decide to induce me if I was only 36 weeks? He was like, no, we'd wait until you were at least 38, but you're 40, so we may as well get that baby out. And I said, well, you know, if he needs longer to cook, he needs longer to cook, you know. I said, well, you know, I've been collecting my data, and I think you might be off. Like, you estimated from the date of my last period. I took my temperature every day. I knew when I ovulated. I knew intercourse. I had it all down. So I said, your estimate might be off by a week or two. And then he said, well, ma'am, you know, we just don't want you to miscarry this baby, because when you go past your due date, your probability of miscarrying doubles. And so this was really sort of meant to scare me, like, listen, it's going to double, so we just got to get the baby out before you lose the baby, right? And I said, whoa, oh my gosh, doubles like 30 to 60%. Like, what's doubling? You know, what is this chance? He said, well, you know, look, don't worry about the details. Don't you worry your pretty little head about that. Let's just get you a room. And so I said, okay, out of 1,000 women, how many of them are going to miscarry just before their due date? And he says, well, 1 in 1,000. I said, so then how many are going to miscarry just after their due date? And he says, well, 2 in 1,000. Now, for those three women, that's huge. So I don't mean to belittle it. But the percentage goes from 0.1% to 0.2%. So the doubling was a bit misleading. And, you know, I didn't walk in and say, by the way, I have a PhD in statistics. I do data and statistics all day. Show me probability. Like, you know, I didn't come in that way. I just came in as a pregnant woman who wanted good care by a person who had not seen me before. This was the first time of him seeing me. And so I mentioned, I said, listen, I've been collecting data. I've got data charting of, you know, my cycle. I can pinpoint conception. And so I know I have a precise measurement of how many weeks along I am. And this was in 2012. So this is, you know, now you tell your doctor, I've got data. They're like, show me your data. Yay. 2012, they were like, get your little Google search out of here. I don't want to see what you got. So here's what some of that data looked like. I had been taking my waking body temperature every morning. And you'll notice that this data has sort of a lower level and a higher level in it. And so, ladies, what we observe early in our cycle, the estrogen is the dominant hormone. So estrogen causes a suppression of your body temperature. up until ovulation. Ovulation is when your body releases an egg and says, hey, we're available to get pregnant, impregnate us. After ovulation, the hormone progesterone is dominant. Progestation is there to encourage your body to get pregnant. Your temperature rises. You see an actual temperature shift if you were to collect this data, which I encourage you to, on a daily basis. The reason for that is the same reason that a mother hen might sit on her eggs. Your body temperature is raising because of the possibility of keeping a young person warm. So it's heating up in preparation. And then if there is no pregnancy, your menstrual cycle will start as your body kicks estrogen back into your system again, and it just repeats over and over and over. Okay. Here is one of my actual charts. So this is when I would chart. Now you've got apps to do it, but back in my day, we would have a little chart next to my bed in the morning and a thermometer. Right? Now there are devices you can sleep in, and it just automatically submits it to your phone. So here I was charting, and you'll notice I had some low temperatures. And then I had a shift in temperature where I ovulated. And then I actually had a second shift in temperature, which will happen if you get pregnant. So whenever you get pregnant, your body temperature has shifted, and it will stay here for the duration of the pregnancy, right? Because it's keeping and incubating that little baby. We were really excited about this. We did a pregnancy test. We were, in fact, pregnant. And then a few days later, we noticed some spotting, and then my cycle started again, right? So I had about a 41-day cycle, which was the longest I'd ever had. And what I actually had was an early-stage miscarriage. Even though this was a really sad event, it was good in that I had the data to meet with my doctor and say, hey, here's what happened. We had a second temperature shift. We were pregnant, and we lost this baby. What can we do to prevent it from happening in the future? There are progesterone creams that you can rub on your arm to keep your levels of progesterone higher so that the baby has time to sort of attach and latch on. So lots of different things to do in that case. And so we were really excited because we were collecting this data, and so we could see, of course, eventually we got pregnant again, and along came Micaiah, our third son. And so that was really, of course, wonderful. Okay. So how many of you collect some personal data now? What are the ways that you collect it? What do you collect? How do you collect it? What do you do with it when you collect it? Yes.
Well, my friend and I here, we kind of do the same thing, but he collects more. So I collect my cholesterol, my glucose, daily weight, the food I eat, measurements.
And what do you do with that? Do you like do something with it daily or
I track it over time and adjust my lifestyle and food intake based on the data.
Oh, I love that. Yes. Woo! Who wants to come after that? My goodness. Like what else do you track? Over here, yeah. Oh. We got one here and then all the way in the back.
I track my blood pressure due to what I thought was a cardiac episode last year. So I've been meeting with an interventional cardiologist for several months now, and everything seems to be normal, but I just know I need to monitor that.
Oh, wonderful. Yes, we have a comment all the way over here in the back. Yes.
So body composition, a few blood markers from ApoB to triglycerides to inflammation levels to iron levels, and I try to use them to both monitor my diet and control my levels of activity as well.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I love that. I love that. Other ways that you collect data, types of data that you collect? These are great. There are so many things that we can wear that automatically collect that data for us. Often we're taking our blood pressure, or if we've, you know, if we've got hypertension or high sugar, maybe we're doing our pulse rate.
we're documenting our nutrition. What are we eating? How often are we eating it? Is it good for us? So lots of ways that we can collect and use that personal data. My family tries to stay active and healthy, and we try to track some of that data. So this is my husband and I during a spin class, our son Micaiah trying to probably bench press 10 pounds or something like that. We got Fitbit watches one Christmas for the whole family. And so we were like incentivizing the boys to move around, but making it a family competition. So here you'll see our family members here. And then the kids were able to go into the app and sort of see their average, see how often they're standing up during the day, compete to get at the top of the list. I'm sure I probably came back and won that week, even though I was in second place. So this has been really wonderful. So then often we're generating this data and collecting it almost just because it's on my watch. Like technically I can pull this stuff up, but I don't really do anything with it. So how do we start to move from just observing data, it's nice that I got 10,000 steps, to generating the type of data that we want to see for the transformation that we want to see? So you said, I'm collecting this data, but I'm also looking at my weight. And if my weight moves in a direction, I'm going to adjust what I eat to then change my weight, right? So how do we move from observing to then generating the data that we want? This was Donald's blood pressure measurements over about a year and a half. You'll notice that he starts in the pre-hypertension, hypertension zone, and then he gets down to around the normal zone in July of 2012. The way that he generated that data was literally by changing what he ate and changing his lifestyle. So we adopted a much more fitness lifestyle. We went to plant-based, and he lost a little over 100 pounds. This is him in one side of an old pair of pants in our bathroom. This picture was also in the TED Talk, so I didn't think it was going to get seen to 2 million people. But since it has, I guess you can also see what our bathroom looks like. So this is a great example, right, of thinking about the type of data that I want to see, getting out of that heart rate zone, which also runs in our family to the genetics comment, but then doing what it takes to change the body so that we can then change our health from the inside out. My husband is a stickler. He loves to play racquetball. That's his sport of choice. And he's also very detail-oriented. So notice here he has racquetball singles with Zachary, won 4 of 4 games. Like, who says that? Who's like, by the way, I won all 4 games that we played. And then here you see his heart rate trace. So the red zone is the highest heart rate intensity, followed by yellow and then green. And then here's another day he played racquetball. Oh, so yeah, highlight, here are those peaks. He's hitting heart rates above 200. Here's another day he played with Jimmy. He won 1 and lost 2 of the games. Aw, that's so unfortunate. And so I sat down with him to look at these two data sets, and I said, there's a difference that I see when I look at where you won 4 of 4 games versus when you won 1 and then you lost the other 2. I said, notice up here, his heart rate gets high and it stays high. It stays elevated, he's winning. And then down below, it looks like he's sort of cooling off in between the matches. So I said, honey, what happened in this game? He said, oh, after each game, we came out, we sat down, we toweled off, I had a drink of water, and then I started the second game. And over here, we just kept running it back. Like, okay, we'll run it back, run it back. I said, well, when you're running it back, your heart rate's in the zone, and it seems like you're much more sort of able to move around the room and get the result that you want. I also collect my data. I'm often doing workouts where I maybe go for a jog on the treadmill or get on the bike. And so I'll get my heart rate elevated and maybe do like a 20-minute workout, and then I'm good to go. Or if I'm in the weight room, I'm just sort of doing some things and my heart rate is just sort of moving around, you know, adjusting to what I'm doing. But I started doing research on exercise that was meant to intentionally work your heart out. Right? Because if you think about it, if you go on a run, your heart doesn't have to work that hard. Once it gets you up to the level where you're running, it's just sort of maintaining. When you do HIIT training, high intensity interval training, you're putting your heart sort of through a workout, right? Through the actions that you do. So I did some research on HIIT training and realized that my data was not putting my heart in a workout. It was heart healthy because I was moving, but it wasn't really training my heart. So then I said, well, maybe I need to do workouts that are gonna be more intentional. And so you see that come out in some of the data where I then started to incorporate high intensity interval training because it was giving my heart a better workout, right? Taking it up, bringing it down, taking it up, bringing it down. And when you do this type of workout, it actually lowers your resting heart rate because you're putting your heart through such a heavy workout that then you end up with a lower heart rate, right? And then this was an interesting research that looked at runners and sort of what is the motivational value of sharing your workouts with other people. Okay, so how many of you have anybody done Peloton rides before? And y'all no, we don't do Peloton. Any kind of group-based workout activity? Are you at a gym? Do you do a Zumba class or a sport pickleball? Is all the rave? All of these things are great because the research shows that part of the community of working out in community also motivates you to keep doing it. Right? I've got a group that I show up to. I've got a class. I've got an instructor that I follow on Instagram, so I'm going to do that class. And that also really helps us to move and be intentional. So this data was looking at runners, and it was looking at sort of how they do, what makes them want to share their data with each other, and how does it benefit them. And so they said often they want to get maybe recognition among the group. They want to compare their data to other runners. They want to have sort of a cheerleading section to cheer them on when they don't feel like working out on a particular day. And so the results showed that when you share exercise data with others on an ongoing basis, it supports your athletic behavior, so you're more likely to stay engaged in the activity. And it's mediated by sort of social peer support, almost like peer pressure too, right? Because when you miss out, they're like, where were you? We didn't see you at the pickleball court. Last thing I'll share before we do a fun exercise together. A lot of the work that I've been able to do in Southern California has also involved thinking about how do we broaden participation in the mathematical sciences? How do we get more girls? How do we get more women of color excited about math and statistics? And so each year I do a STEM conference for underrepresented girls at Harvey Mudd, where I invite them to campus. And we were featured in an article on Forbes magazine on increasing educational opportunities for minorities in STEM. So this was really great that they got to highlight some of the girls, talk about the conference and how it has impacted the girls in our community. Every year that we do the conference, we invite women who are working in STEM to come and talk about the work that they do. So we have these really sort of small group sessions and keynotes. We also give them some one-on-one time with a mentor, so somebody that they can ask questions to and get to know and really be inspired by. And then I love to give the girls a space to share something. So we have some activity for them to do. This particular year, it was the girls had to come up with an inspiration equation. What's your inspiration equation? How would you write yourself as a math equation? And so that was really neat to sort of see the things that they came up with, like I am my mom, plus my dad, plus art and drama, minus my brother squared. I mean, it was just neat to see the things that they give priority to in their life and the things that they don't. The first year that we did this conference, we had all these activities planned for the girls, and we were just like, hey, parents, come back later. Go to Costco, do what you got to do, do some shopping. We'll see you at 3 o'clock. And the parents were just like, I'm not leaving my daughter on this college campus. I will be right here in this room in case she needs anything. And so we started doing a parent workshop. We started planning, like, if the parents are going to say it, we should, have activities for them. So we reached out to the Claremont High School. We invited their guidance counselor to come and meet with the parents. We had speakers for the parents. And this is really sort of an area that I think we don't invest as much time in. We're often investing in the next generation and the kids, but not thinking about the parents who have to sort of get them through middle and high school. And so this was really great because our parents had questions about, if my daughter has a question about math and I can't help her, what do I do? So we did some really fun practical exercises with them to really encourage them to support both, their kids and STEM in general. You'll recognize these t-shirts, these beautiful yellow t-shirts from MoMath. In addition to Nova Wonders, I've gotten to partner with PBS on our most recent series, Zero to Infinity, which we taped some of that here in New York, and so that was really fun. Zero Infinity sort of looks at the history of the number zero and infinity and sort of where that arose in mathematics. And looking at sort of the origins, but in a way that's really exciting and engaging the public. Okay, here we go.
Mind-bending ideas. Discover Southeast concepts. Revolutionized mathematics. Simplest.
And the most influential, the most profound.
Whoa!
It's the story of nothing.
Who knew you could learn so much from pizza?
And everything.
It's all one big principle.
Zero to infinity on Nova.
Okay, so the first clip is on understanding infinity that we got to tape here at MoMA.
If you want to understand what infinity can do, we're going to need pizza.
Pizza? Yes, there's a science to making pizza.
We don't typically associate pizza with infinity.
Yeah. Don't solve one of the most elusive mysteries of early mathematics.
So, Steve, how is this pizza going to help us understand infinity?
I would say it the other way. Infinity and the pizza are going to help us understand one of the oldest problems in math.
Mm-hmm.
What's the area of a circle?
Which is not intuitive.
No. You know, what's hard about it? You might think a circle is a beautiful, simple shape, but actually it's got this nasty property that it doesn't have any straight lines in it.
Right.
Ancient civilizations didn't know how to find the area of a shape like that.
How to find the exact area of a circle isn't obvious. For a square or rectangle, you just multiply the sides. But what do you do with a circle?
So what did they do?
Well, they came up with an argument that you can convert a round shape into a rectangle if you use infinity.
So we're basically going to kind of deconstruct this pizza, make it into a rectangle.
Beautiful.
And then we're going to know the area.
That's it. So I'm going to start with four pieces.
Okay.
To do that, I'm going to go 1 point up and 1 point down.
Mm-hmm.
And then 1 point up and 1 point down. And yeah, like that.
How'd you do in geometry?
You don't think that looks like
that
a rectangle?
Is not close to a rectangle.
No, it's not. No, it's not. No. But come on, I'm only using four pieces. If I use more, I can get closer.
Okay.
So we got to cut these babies in half.
Let's cut them.
Let's rearrange them. Same trick, alternating point up and point down. One up and one down. One up and one down.
There.
That is looking a lot better.
Aww.
What do you think? Is that a rectangle?
It's not quite a rectangle, but it's getting closer.
It is, right?
Yeah.
In both the four-piece and eight-piece versions, half the crust sits at the top and half at the bottom. But with eight pieces, the edge becomes less scalloped, closer to a straight line.
So we need to go at least a step further.
Let's go more. We got to do 16. So we have to just change every other one. Am I going to mess this up? I mean, that's a parallelogram that's aspiring to be a rectangle. That's got aspirations.
Yeah, it's got high hopes. It's got high hopes, I tell you.
From four slices to eight slices to 16 slices and even 32 slices, there's a clear progression towards a rectangle. With one piece out of 32 cut in half to create vertical sides, the rectangle is almost complete, except for the wavy top and bottom. But as the number of slices increases, the straighter and straighter those edges would become.
And the argument here is that if we could keep doing this all the way out to infinity, mm-hmm. so that this would be infinitely many slices, infinitesimally thin, this really would become a rectangle.
Yeah.
And we can read off the area.
That's right. This
radius, that's the distance from the center out to the crust,
mm-hmm.
times half the circumference, which is half the crust, half the curvy stuff. And that's a famous formula. Half the crust times the radius.
Yeah.
One half CR.
That's what the C is.
Usually C for circumference, but you could see it's crust.
So at the limit, once we got all the way out there, it's going to look like a rectangle.
It would be a rectangle, and that is actually the first calculus argument in history,
yeah.
like 250 BC, to find the area of a circle.
Who knew you could learn so much from pizza?
Infinity is your friend in math, and that's the great insight of calculus, that you can rebuild the world out of much simpler objects as long as you're willing to use infinitely many of them.
Great. And then the last stuff I want to show you is Zeno's paradox.
Zeno suggested that we consider an arrow in flight at any instant in time. And at that instant, that now moment, the arrow is frozen in space, motionless. It's neither arriving nor leaving. And if you consider the entire flight, there's an infinity of those motionless, frozen moments in time and space. So Zeno asked, is the flight of the arrow and all motion really just an illusion?
His radical conclusion is that motion is impossible. At a given instant, that arrow is someplace. And then click time forward, it's at some other place, but at no moment was it moving.
And when you're ready, let go.
What? Did you hear that? Did you hear that?
Well, the motion of an arrow looks real enough for me.
That's right, Katniss got nothing on me.
But you can see why Zeno's timeless frozen moments are so problematic. Our whole notion of speed depends on time. Here's the formula. Distance traveled divided by length of time equals speed. But Zeno's frozen moment has a length of time of zero. That means trying to divide by zero, which is against the rules of division. But at the same time, we often want to know the speed of something in motion at a particular instant. One solution to the problem of instantaneous speed is a concept called a limit. Let's consider a stick figure who walks half the distance to a wall and does that again, and again, and again. If the stick figure keeps going half the distance to the wall, they'll get closer and closer, but the steps will get smaller and smaller, and they'll never reach the wall. The wall is an example of a limit. As the number of steps heads to infinity, the distance to the wall decreases towards zero. But the figure will never reach the wall.
You're getting infinitely close to a limit as far as you're gonna get, but you never actually get there, which, yeah, it's one of those concepts that bothers a lot of people, even mathematicians it bothers, I think.
I can never start with a whole number and divide it by something to get zero. There's no way for me to ever get to zero.
Even if you have an itty bitty bit and you divide it in half, you still don't have zero.
Harnessing the power of infinity through limits gives mathematicians a workaround to the problem of dividing by zero, and in turn, opens the door to a world of solutions to some extremely difficult problems. It helped create a new field of mathematics, calculus.
And that's really the big idea at the heart of calculus, as understood in modern terms, this idea of a limit, that you're supposed to think, how far did I go over a microsecond? That gives me an approximation to my instantaneous velocity, you know, the distance traveled divided by that duration. But that's not yet an instant. So rather than a microsecond, I think now a nanosecond, 1,000 times shorter. How far did I travel then? That gives me a better approximation. And in this limit, as the duration of time goes to zero, you often find you'll get a well-defined limiting answer for the speed, and that limit is what's called the instantaneous velocity.
The fun thing about partnering with PBS and NOVA is that they also make these clips available for K-12 teachers to put in their classroom, so on their learning media site, and so it was really fun to take some of these clips and then think about how they might be shared out in the classroom. This is one from Zeno's Paradox, so you'll notice that they've got teaching tips, an answer key, because come on, we all need the answers. Some support materials, some background reading for students to do, some discussion questions, and even handouts. So that's really great for teachers to engage in their classroom and sort of talk about some of the concepts that we talk about in the show. Lastly, I'll share before we do our activity together, I love getting feedback and hearing from people who have been impacted by the show. This one says, Dear Dr. Williams, I just wanted to write to let you know how much I enjoyed your PBS program on zero and infinity. I am not a mathematician, but as a fellow professor, I was curious to see how one could present something somewhat mundane, zero, and something abstract, infinity, in an interesting way. And I feel that you were a smashing success. Congratulations on presenting such an interesting program. And then this one came, hello, I'm the mother of a five-year-old boy with autism. His special interest happens to be numbers and the history of numbers. And we came across Zero to Infinity on PBS. He has watched it at least 20 times this week, and he begged me to tell you that he liked you very much and that it must be very fun to have a job where you can be surrounded by so many numbers. Wishing you a very Merry Christmas. Best regards from Max in Sweden. And then recently I got an email from a young girl named Zoe who, for Black History Month, she said, my class is dressing up and I want to dress up as you for Black History Month. And I was just like, oh, right, bless your heart, Zoe, but honey, I'm just not old enough. Listen, you got to go get the ancestors, you know, you can't do uh-uh. And like, how do you dress up as your favorite professor? Like, what do you wear? You know, there's not like a white coat, there's not a uniform. But her mom said she really wanted to, so we did a Zoom call, and she had all her little questions. And so I said, well, Zoe, honey, what's your outfit? You got She's like, yes, I have an outfit, like, all together. And I was like, okay. And so her mom emailed me this. Yes, she nailed it. She got her little poster together and nailed the look. So that was really sweet. And then I actually got to meet Zoe not too long ago, last March. And so that was really great to connect with her. Okay, last thing I want to do, you've got a clipboard with you. So we are going to do this activity together. And so we've talked about cardiovascular and heart health. Now we're going to do it in practice and generate some data. First thing I want you to do is calculate your maximum heart rate. So that's going to be 220 minus your age, whatever your age is. If you're 10, lucky you. If you're 17, if you're 52, right? 220 minus your age. Go ahead and fill in your maximum heart rate. If you need a calculator, that's okay. That's okay, don't be ashamed. All right, and then you're gonna do some activities below. Which of them do you expect to have the highest heart rate? Resting, sitting, standing, walking, running, jumping. We're not going to do jumping jacks. You can scratch through five. Okay, you got your max heart rate? All right, so here's how we're going to do this. You are going to count the number of beats per 30 seconds. I'm going to time you, so find a way to get either maybe from your wrist or this is sort of, make sure you can feel your pulse. Feel it. And then I'm going to set a timer for 30 seconds, and I'm going to have you count how many beats you feel in 30 seconds. And then we're going to write that down and multiply it by 2 to get our beats per minute. Yes? Questions? Okay, you got your pulse rate? Ready and count. Stop. Okay, and you're gonna write that number down in beats per 30 seconds. So how many beats did you count? And then multiply that by 2 to get your beats per minute. And put that in the second column. Well, the third column. Great, once you get that, go ahead and stand. So you got your resting, sitting heart rate. All right, you may want, you know, just sort of stretch out a little bit, get the blood flowing. So now we want to see, how does your heart rate change if it changes as you stand up? So notice as you stand, your body's going to have to then sort of start pumping blood from your feet to your head. All right, find that pulse rate again. And we're gonna start counting in 3, 2, 1, go. Okay, are you ready? We're gonna get some walking data. So walk around if you want. You can maybe make a loop around your row, or you can come up here, walk around for a minute. So go ahead and get a spot. I'm gonna set a timer for 1 minute and keep walking. Go, go, go. Three, two, one. Okay, stop. All right, and then go ahead and let's get our hands on our pulse. We're gonna start collecting our pulse rate. Ready? Go. All right, write down that number of beats in 30 seconds, and then multiply by 2. But we are gonna do, we're gonna skip jumping jacks. We're gonna do running in place. So maybe just a little jog, all right? For about, there you go. If you wanna do some high knees, you know, if that's your athletic ability, go ahead and start. You got 1 minute to sort of run in place. Look at, now is your time. Yes, get it all out, get it all out. Yes, if you want to move those arms a little bit. If you've got some weigh-in goals to meet, this is your time to go ahead and push yourself. If you missed your workout today, this is a good time to, you know, make up for that. 2, 1, stop. Okay, get that hand on your pulse. Ready? And start counting now. Stop. All right, so go ahead and note that under running in place for 1 minute, your beats for 30 seconds, and then multiply that number by 2 to get your beats per minute. And then once you get that, go ahead and take your seat. We're gonna sit and just rest for a minute. And then we're gonna get your heart rate one more time, right? So now that you've done a little bit of activity, you've gotten it raised, we're gonna give you a minute, let it rest, and sort of see how far you're able to get back down after some strenuous activity. All right, so keep resting, keep resting. All right, and now get your pulse one more time, and we're gonna find our heart rate after resting for a minute. Ready, and go. And stop. All right, go ahead and note that resting heart rate. And then multiply that number by 2 to get your beats per minute. Great, all right, let's talk through some of those discussion questions. Why is it important to calculate your resting heart rate? Why do we care about your resting heart rate? Why is that important?
It's our baseline.
It's your baseline, absolutely.
Right, kind of gives you a measure of how hard your heart has to work just on a normal, regular basis. Yeah? What activity for you gave you the lowest heart rate? What was your lowest heart rate? Hopefully it was sitting, right? Hopefully before you sit up, yes? Okay, great. What effect did walking have on your heart rate? Did you notice your heart rate increase after you walked around for a bit? What about after you stood up? Did any of you sort of stay the same, or did everybody increase after, even with just standing, that caused you to go up a little bit? Yeah? Awesome. What about running? You got to some zones, you were like, whoa, okay, max heart rate. Okay, we're gonna get, yeah. Awesome. What do you think happens to your resting heart rate over time if you have a regular workout program? What happens to your resting heart rate over time? It's gonna go down, right? So the more you exercise that heart and put it under pressure, then the less it has to work when you're resting, right? So you end up actually having a lower resting heart rate because your heart doesn't have to work as hard because it knows that you're gonna push it to some extremes, right? Thank you for letting me do this activity and collect this data with you. I really appreciate the time that I got to spend today, and I want to open the floor if you have any questions or comments. So thank you so much.
Well, this is really interesting. Thank you, and for showing the data in the earlier tables. What's a good website to go to if we want to get more granular info, like by zip code or by state or even just New York City, things like that? And maybe a breakdown of longevity as well. Mm-hmm. Thanks.
The CDC has great data on mortality in addition to just sort of health data. It's downloadable and it's accessible. So that's probably the number one website that I'd recommend. And they also build it from the census. So every year that we do a census, they are able to update that data pretty closely correlated with the census. So yes, CDC has tons of data on human and health statistics. Yeah.
All right, we got a question up front.
Yes, yes. Oh, yes, woo! What's your question?
I don't know how my heart rate is that is
248.
248. He wants to know why that was higher than his max.
Ooh, why was that higher than your max heart rate? Good question. What do you guys think? Why did he get a heart rate that was higher than his max? Like his little heart's just pumping away. Yeah, so the way that we calculate max heart rate is really very generic, right? So if I take 220 and subtract, your age was what, seven? It doesn't account for all seven-year-olds. It's just sort of the average seven-year-old would have this number, right? Just like when I subtract my age, which I won't tell you, but that's a nice number. But then if I work out more, right, if my heart is healthier, then my heart is gonna be able to get to higher zones. So remember when I showed you Donald's racquetball data and he had, I hit these red zones and my heart rate was in the 200s. Well, his max heart rate technically is 187. So he's able to get his heart higher than what's his technical max just because he's healthier. So it might be that we're healthier and so our heart's able to hit higher zones than sort of the standard. Yeah. That's a great question, I love that, yes! Other questions or comments?
All right, we have, time for this one last question.
Hi, so I was really interested in the racquetball data that was shown. I'm curious if, as you or your family consume data through platforms like Fitbit or Apple, do you use the analytics that are offered through the providers, or do you export the data and do your own things that we can't do in the commercial product?
We use the data that's included in our app, or like I've never exported my data from Apple or tried to sort of analyze it myself. It's usually just through the mechanism of the app and then just looking at the output. And then for some apps, I'm not able to get my data file in a way that's easily downloadable, like maybe under the thing that we all agree to is like they keep your data and so you don't have access to it. And I haven't tried with Apple Health. I don't use Apple Health as much. I tend to use apps that are specific like for weight or for blood pressure or, you know. And in those apps, I'm able to generate like the graphs, the data that you saw, I can do that. But I'm not able to like actually get those numbers and play around with them or model the trend over time, which would be great. Unfortunately. With my temperature data, when I was collecting it by hand, in theory, I had it all and I could like enter it and then plot it. And so that was really fun. But now the app that I use, I've never tried to download that data, actually. That would be really interesting to see if there's an easy way to download it. I usually just look in the app and sort of do trends in the app. So, yeah.
If you could get it out, what would you want to do?
Oh, I mean, golly. Yes. So if I could get access to that data, what would I do with it? I think for my weight data, I'd probably want to understand my weight and maybe correlate it with my nutrition, because I do sort of keep track of my nutrition. And so really sort of seeing maybe the delay, like what's my Thanksgiving delay if I'm going through Thanksgiving, when does that show up on the scale? Or when I'm eating in a way that either is really healthy, maybe I try a raw vegan diet for a week, at what point does it start to show up then in the data? So I'd want to maybe even see sort of the time display between the thing that I'm doing to change my data and then when it actually shows up in the data. Yeah, that's awesome. Yeah,
all right, let's give one last round of applause to our presenter.